praising God, and it is something you can do and very likely might be doing this very minute if you believe the things that I'm about to relate here. Because just so I can contrast it with what we used to believe, the reality or the truth compared to that, what is that? The old way was praising God is flattery. It's flattering him as someone who is something of a sugar daddy or a gift giver, someone who gives you things in response to you telling him how great he is. And the more emotionally or boisterously or in whatever big production you can do to flatter him in that type of praise, in that type of system, you're taught, and we were taught and programmed to believe that that is how you praise him in order to get this effect of blessings, as it was called. And that's not true. That's a lie of religion that we no longer believe, because we realize now we do praise him. We praise him all the time. We live a life of praise towards God because praise is about belief. So I'm going to read some scripture that backs that up clearly so you can be happy about it. If you might find out, or if you don't already know, we found out, I found out, I was praising God all the time. I just didn't know it because I did believe him. I cannot say bad things about my God. You know, my God is not petty. I do believe he's jealous for me, but not the way we understand jealousy. He will not let anyone love me the way he can love me. We're all designed to need that same love, so we are not able to give the love that only he can give. But he's not a petty God who needs his ego stroked with all types of flattery. He knows who he is. He's quite confident in who he is. He knows he's good. He doesn't need me to tell him that. It's to my benefit, however, when I realize and believe that. I believe that he's good. So when we go to Ephesians chapter 1 here, I'm going to start in verse 3. Remember, praise is believing. It's finding out information. It's not just believing for no reason. There is information involved here in exchange. God has shown certain things. He has done certain things and revealed certain things. And we have an opportunity, an option, a choice to respond in belief. To either receive that and believe that or reject that. We all have that opportunity. We all have that choice. We are not predestined for these things. And this section is used by people who believe in predestination, as in God picks winners and losers, God picks souls for heaven, and God picks souls for hell. That's not what it's about. It's another side thing I'm going to throw in here. So like I say, Ephesians chapter 1, starting in verse 3, he said, "Blessed is the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who blessed us with every spiritual blessing in the heavenlies with Christ," comma. So that's not the end of that sentence, but I just wanted to emphasize what I started out with. Praise is belief. Paul makes a statement. If you don't believe that God has blessed you with every spiritual blessing in the heavenlies with himself, with Christ, then that's not going to benefit you. But it's the same as if it's not true if you don't believe it's true. So you have to believe that. I believe he has blessed me. My wife and I both believe that he has blessed us with every spiritual blessing in the heavenlies with him. We believe that. I have all spiritual blessings. They belong to me. He gave them to me. I didn't earn them. I didn't acquire them through something I did. He did all the work. He did all the achieving. He did all the acquiring. And he simply offered them to me. And I see that and I believe that. And now I have them. Verse 4. Even as he elected us in him before the foundation of the world, for us to be holy and without blemish before him in love. Saying in verse 4, again, it's a comma. It's kind of a long sentence Paul is going through. But I mentioned that earlier that they talk about election and selection and all that. Some for heaven, some for hell. He elected us in him. In other words, in himself. How are you in him? You're in him. But again, observing realities, observing facts, taking in this information and believing it. That's how you are placed in the body of God, the body of Christ. He selected him. That's his chosen servant, which is himself coming into the world. His word came into the world to do something, to achieve something, to accomplish something. and it did not fail. Those who put our trust in that true word, the word of God, the Son of God, are in him. So we are chosen in that sense. He didn't put me there and force me there. He chose himself to do this work. He did it. I believe in it. I'm in him. And that's how I am elected, through that choice to believe in what he has done. Verse 5, predestinating us to adoption. Again, where or how? Through Jesus Christ to himself, according to the good pleasure of his will. So again, that predestination to the adoption through Jesus Christ. That's how the predestination is. It's all in the operation of him and what he did and whether or not you believe. It's not because he liked you or he chose you against your will for this destination or that. He chose Christ and those who believe in him. And who else can he choose besides himself anyway? It had to be him. There's no one else who can execute or perform or do perfectly what he wanted to be done. That's why he had to come here as a man. A man had to do it. It was given to a man in the garden. We surrendered it. We gave it over to the enemy. A man had to get it back. But a man, a regular man, couldn't. So the God-man, Jesus Christ, came in and did it. Verse 6, to the praise of the glory of his grace, in which he favored us in the one having been loved. 7, in whom we have redemption through his blood, the remission of deviations according to the riches of his grace, which he caused to abound toward us in all wisdom and understanding. It's a really long sentence. I'm resisting breaking up every time he comes to a comma, because each verse ends in a comma. It doesn't end the sentence. So I want to go back there a little bit. In fact, reestablish it by starting in verse 3, because verse 6, when it says, to the praise of the glory of his grace, that's a huge thing, because remember, I'm talking about praise here. When you know in your heart who God is and who it is that gave himself for you, you live a life of praise. You have a heart of praise. You can only tell the truth of the goodness of your God to people. That is praising God. You cannot lie about him. You cannot tell someone, look, your God is disgusted with you. Hey, your God really has problems with you. You need to fix these issues that God does not like about you. You can't do that. You can't lie about him. You can only praise him. Because that is not praising God, to say that God has all these things against you, because that's not a God of love. God does not love you if he has all kinds of problems with you that you can't fix. And you can't fix them. Trust me, you cannot fix them. The only one that can fix them is him. So that's why he just decided to make us holy. He just decided to make us saints. He just decided to make us part of his body. Again, not against our will, but according to our belief, our trust, our faith in that perfect work that only he can do. And he will not stop until he is finished. And I put my faith in that. So I see that as to that praise. I praise him in my spirit is that of praise towards him. Not so I can be in a special decorated and painted facility for the purpose of showing others and or God how much I praise him and how much I laud him and how much I flatter him so that people can see that I'm a really good praise person. No, it's a spontaneous thing. It comes out of me because of reality, because of truth, because of information that I see and I evaluate and I believe it. So it's just a spontaneous thing that comes out of you. The angels aren't praising him because they're ordered to. The angels are praising him because they can't help it. Because it's just a spontaneous thing that comes out of them. You can't help it when you see how good your God is. You don't have to force it. You don't have to prove it to anyone. If you're not doing it the way they think you're supposed to do it, and you're just at peace knowing your God loves you, you are still praising him, because it's going to be a relationship between you and him. And if he wants to urge you to do something like that, to give you that unction, to praise in some way, whether it's singing a song or jumping up and down, then he'll do it. But you don't have to do it to get his attention, because it's what he does in your heart, because God looks in the heart. It's not about the outward appearance. It's not about all these outward things we do. But like I say, I want to go back and read that from verse 3. Blessed is the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who blessed us with every spiritual blessing in the heavenlies with Christ, even as he elected us in him before the foundation of the world, for us to be holy and without blemish before him in love, predestinating us to adoption through Jesus Christ in himself, according to the good pleasure of his will. See, if you believe all that, I mean, I'm getting excited to just read it. It's amazing. All those things are true about me and about him. I shouldn't say in that order. All those things are true about him and about me. He did all that, and I believe in that, and I am now adopted through Jesus Christ. I am one chosen by him because of the fact that I believe in the actions that he took. So that results in verse 6, to the praise of the glory of his grace in which he favored us in the one having been loved. In other versions it says, in the beloved. Same meaning there. But to the praise of the glory of his grace. The glory of his grace. It's not the glory of his awesomeness or that he is so great and he can crush you like a pebble or he could devour anything or he can shake mountains. The glory, the true and greatest glory of who God is and what he's done is his grace. It's his kindness. And that was shown and revealed by his actions, by becoming a man, by becoming one of us. And we see that, and that causes that praise, that spirit of praise that is in us, that we can only speak good things about him. And it doesn't have to be in some formal praise and worship thing where you are in a band or in a rock show or anything like that. It's just something he does to your spirit that you can only testify to the goodness of your God. You can only praise him. And that grace, just like it says in Philippians, paraphrase it here, it says that every knee will bow and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. That's to the glory of God the Father, because it is glorious that God came here as that man. That's why it's glorious to the Father, because that's who the Father is. The Father humbled himself and became like a man. Became as a man, and he humbled himself and brought himself down and showed us that grace, that perfect grace and love and acceptance that would risk our rejection when we are confronted with these realities and we wouldn't praise. Instead, we would reject it and say, that's okay, I don't want it, I don't believe it, whatever. That is glorious. That is amazing grace. Verse 7, in whom we have redemption through his blood, the remission of deviations. Again, I understand most versions say remission of sins. That's the taking away, the forgiveness, the removal. According to the riches of his grace. So, he makes a statement about who Christ is. And he's talking about God. And he says, in whom we have redemption. We have redemption. The whole world is reconciled because of what he did on the cross. But reconciliation is not life, eternal. It's not salvation. Reconciliation is now the whole world has an opportunity to connect with their God directly without anything between them and their God. There's just you and him. Before, it was you, sin, then him. He reconciled that. So we're all reconciled, but we are not all redeemed. The way you become redeemed is in him through his blood, because it's not only that he did it, you look at it, and again, you believe. And that spirit of praise is simultaneous with your redemption. You realize what he did for you. You are redeemed. And you're filled with that spirit of praise. Your redemption causes that praise in you because you see what has been done for you and who did it for you. It's in him and through his blood. The remission of deviations. According to the riches of his grace. In other words, he desired that. He desired it so much that even though his flesh didn't want to go through it, let this cup pass from me. Remember he said that. It was still the riches of his grace was that he would do it anyway. He would still do it according to the will of the Father who dwells within him. That's the true desire he has, is to give you that so you can have all your deviations, all your sins removed, remitted, forgiven, taken away. That is the riches of his grace, that he would give himself to actuate that, to actually make that happen. Verse 8. Which he caused to abound toward us in all wisdom and understanding. The remission of the sins, the riches of his grace, the redemption that is in his blood, in all wisdom and understanding. That is all wisdom and understanding. All wisdom and understanding is about you have a God and he is rich in mercy. And he would and has done anything and everything he can possibly do so that you and him can be together forever. Verse 9, making known to us the mystery of his will, according to his good pleasure, which he purposed in himself. In himself, does that not make it clear? Jesus Christ is the one who purposes these things in himself. He's the one who did it. There's only one who can do it, and that's God. So he makes known to us the mystery of his will. In other scriptures, he talks about how the preaching of the cross is foolishness to those that are lost, and it's the power of God to us that believe. It's a mystery until you get that, until you understand that, until you can comprehend that God would do that, that God would give himself for you. That's a mystery. And we'll never reach the full depths of that, but yet we can see it to our salvation, to the fulfilling of his will, that we would be made alive forever, according to his good pleasure, which he purposed in himself. That is a one person, one individual, one God operation. Verse 10, for the administration of the fullness of the times to head up all things in Christ, both the things in the heavens and the things on earth, in him. Again, he's focusing on all this stuff, how it's being done, and in who it is being done. It's all being done in himself. And if it's not being done in God, then we got a problem. There's someone, that means there's someone other than God who's accomplishing this. There isn't someone other than God. There's God and God alone. That's all you know who Christ is. Verse 11, in whom we also have been chosen to an inheritance, being predestined according to the purpose of the one working all things, according to the counsel of his own will. He's working things, all things, according to the counsel of his own will. Again, if you believe in that, then you are part of that. If you don't believe in that, then you're not part of it. He doesn't force his will on you. He is going to do what he is going to do. And he's going to save everyone, that is the entire world, who wants what he has to offer. So, the whole world could be saved, yes. Is the whole world saved? I certainly don't believe so, because I don't see that many people really want that. So maybe that's why he's tarrying. Maybe that's why he's waiting so long to get more people, because it seems so few people really want that or believe that, or have a response, but when they see this, a response of praise in your spirit. If you read this and your response is a praise, oh my God, you are amazing, you are good. I love to tell of the wonders of who you are and how good you are. Then that says something about you and what he's done to you. I'm not saying about your intrinsic value or you're just naturally good because you see it that way. You see it that way because you've seen how good he is. And that's what changes you. But that most people won't see that. They won't have a response of praise to that. So it doesn't apply to them. It applies to all who believe. Verse 12. For us to be to the praise of his glory, the ones who had previously trusted in Christ, in whom also you, hearing the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, in whom also believing, you were sealed with the Holy Spirit of promise, who is an earnest of our inheritance, to the redemption of the purchased possession, to the praise of his glory. See that? It keeps saying to the praise, to the praise, to the praise. It's to the praise because he gives information, and when you see that, you observe it, you confirm it in your heart, you realize this is true. This is who my God is. My God is the man Christ Jesus. My God became a man on my behalf, and that is to the praise of his glory. When I believe that, again, not a function, not a duty, not an obligation, not a religious sacrament that's laid out for you, and this is how you do it. You burn the incense this way, and you get on your knees that way, and you go to this altar, and you do this. It's spontaneous, and it's just the way you walk in life. You walk in life as a thankful person. Thanks is praise. That's what it is. And sometimes that word is interchangeable. There's a famous prayer where in Matthew 11 where he says, I thank thee, Father. In other versions, it says, I praise thee, Father. Because that is the true essence of what it is to know who your God is to be in a state of thankfulness, in a state of praise. That is true praise. It's thankful. And why wouldn't you be thankful? You're not thankful because you got to have this great faith that he might do something that you wish he would do. You're thankful because of what he's already done. Because his promises are yes and amen. He already did it. So when he says in Mark chapter 11, if you pray believing you already have it, you will have it. Because you do. Because you have the things that are of substance. It's not about praying believing you have something you don't have. That wasn't what he was talking about. He's talking about praying believing that you have him. And you do have him. So you can pray confidently knowing you have him. You have your God. He gave himself for you. So when you pray to him, it's not about praying for things and carnal things and fleshly things. It's about praying for understanding and knowing that he's already offered all these things to you. You have it because he already gave himself for you. He gave you all spiritual blessings in the heavenlies. I'm not saying he doesn't offer or sometimes give you these carnal blessings. He heals people from time to time. I understand he does all kinds of things like that. But that's all secondary. You don't pray knowing you have it, and that's how you get it. Those things are up to him. They're totally up to him. The others are too. He just decided to give you the eternal things right now. They are all yours. And when you believe that, you will praise him because you live a life of praise, a life of thanks. In Jesus' name, amen.